King of the universe, who sanctify us through the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach and his commandments, and has instructed us to hear the call of the shofar and also remember us his coming back. Amen.
Please remain standing and face the east toward Jerusalem as we recite the Shema and the Via Haftah. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Kavod, Malchuto Leolam Voed. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Blessed be his glorious name, whose kingdom is forever and ever. Amen. Via haftah et Adonai Elohecha b'chol levecha uv'chol nafshecha uv'chol meodecha v'chayu haravarim ha'ele asher anachni mitzavacha hayom alivorecha Veshinantam livonecha vetibarta bam v'shiftecha vivatecha uvletecha vaderech ushachbecha uvkumecha ukshatam leot ayodecha v'chayu l'totofot Beinecha uchtavtam amazuzot beitecha uvisharecha. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. These words which I command you this day shall be upon your heart. Teach them diligently to your children. Speak of them when you're sitting in your house, when you're on the road, when you're lying down, and when you're rising up. You shall bind them for a sign upon your hand, and they shall be a symbol between your eyes. Write them on the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. V'ahavtah l'rעך כמוך, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Amen. Ronnie.
Thank you, Gary. Baruchu et Adonai Hamveorach. Baruch Adonai Hamveorach Leolam Vayed. Baruch Adonai Hamveorach Leolam Vayed. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam. Ashir baka banol mikol ha'amin. Venata lano et Torato. Baruch atah Adonai, notein haTorah. Amen. Bless the Lord, the Blessed One. Blessed is the Lord, the Blessed One, for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has chosen us from among the nations and given us his Torah. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Larry.
Shalom. Shabbat shalom, everybody. Our readings this morning out of the Word of God from the Holy Bible. We're going to start in the Torah at Deuteronomy 31 to 16. Deuteronomy 31 to 16. The blessing of returning to God. Now it shall come to pass when all these things come upon you, the blessing and the curse which I have set before you, and you call them to mind among all the nations where the Lord your God drives you, and you return to the Lord your God and obey his voice according to all that I command you today, you and your children, with all your heart and with all your soul, that the Lord your God will bring you back from captivity and have compassion on you and gather you again from all the nations where the Lord your God has scattered you. If any of you are driven out to the farthest parts under heaven, from there the Lord your God will gather you, and from there he will bring you. Then the Lord your God will bring you to the land which your fathers possessed, and you shall possess it. He will prosper you and multiply you more than your fathers. And the Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the heart of your descendants to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, that you may live. Also, the Lord your God will put all these curses on your enemies and on those who hate you, who persecute you. And you will again obey the voice of the Lord and do all his commandments which I command you today. The Lord your God will make you abound in all the work of your hand, and the fruit of your body, and the increase of your livestock, and in the produce of your land for good. For the Lord will again rejoice over you for good, and as he rejoiced over your fathers, if you obey the voice of the Lord your God to keep his commandments and his statutes, which are written in this book of the book I have, and if you and turn from the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. The choice of life or death. For this commandment, which I command you today, is not too mysterious for you, nor is it far off. It is not in heaven that you should say, who will ascend into heaven for us, and who will bring it to us, that we may hear it and do it? Nor is it that beyond the sea, that you should say, who will go over the sea for us to bring it to us, that we may hear it and do it? But the word is very near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that you may do it. See, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil. In that I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways, and to keep his commandments, his statutes, and his judgments, that you may live and multiply, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land which you go to possess. Amen. We'll move on now to the Haftorah, to Isaiah 62, 1 to 12. Assurance of Zion's salvation. For Zion's sake, I will not hold my peace, and for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest until her righteousness goes forth as brightness and her salvation as a lamp that burns. The Gentiles shall see your righteousness, and all the kings your glory. You shall be called by a new name, which the mouth of the Lord will name. You shall also be a crown of glory in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. You shall no longer be termed forsaken, nor shall your land any more be termed desolate, but you shall be called Hephzibah, and your land Beulah. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a virgin, so shall the sons marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. I have set watchmen on your walls, O Jerusalem. They shall never hold their peace day or night. You who make mention of the Lord, do not keep silent, and give him no rest till he establishes, and till he makes the Jerusalem a praise in the earth. The Lord has sworn by his right hand and by the arm of his strength, surely I will no longer give your grain as food for your enemies, and the sons of the foreigner shall not drink your new wine, for which you have labored, but those who have gathered it shall eat it and praise the Lord. Those who have brought it together shall drink it in my holy courts. Go through the gates. Prepare the way for the people. Build up the highway. Take out the stones. Lift up a banner for the peoples. Indeed, the Lord has proclaimed to the end of the world. Say to the daughter of Zion, surely your salvation is coming. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him. And they shall call him the holy people, the redeemed of the Lord. And you shall be called sought out, a city not forsaken. Amen. Amen. We'll move now to the Brit Hadashah, the New Covenant, the New Testament. We'll read out of Romans 10, 1 to 13. Israel needs the gospel. Brethren, my heart's desire and the prayer of the God for Israel is that they may be saved. For I bear them witness that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted to the righteousness of God. For Yeshua, Messiah, is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. For Moses writes about the righteousness which is of the law. The man who does those things shall live by them. But the righteousness of faith speaks in this way. Do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? That is to bring Yeshua, Messiah, down from above. Or who will ascend into the abyss? That is to say, Yeshua, Messiah, up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if you confess with your mouth that Yeshua, Messiah, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Gentile and Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Larry.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, hashir natah lano torat emet, v'gaye olam natam betukenu, baruch atah Adonai, noten haTorah. Amen.
Bless the Lord, the Blessed One. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us a Torah of truth and has planted everlasting life within us. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Amen. Larry. Larry? Yeah.
I think it's Gary. Which I'm lucky to know who I am today. Welcome to our dear visitors today, and I know we have a bunch of them, and I want to welcome you here for the first time and hope that you'll be planning on coming back again. Out back, we have a table with all kinds of literature about us, and you're free to take anything that you want with you to learn more about us. CDs of previous sermons are available at the Oneg Shabbat. Wait, what happened? It changed. Anyway, on the back table we have CDs of all the previous sermons. You're welcome to take what you want, pass them out, listen to them. It'll be a good education. Please join us for Oneg Shabbat after the service. And that's where we eat all the goodies today that have been brought by my beautiful bride-to-be, who looks absolutely gorgeous today. Oh. Ah. Did I embarrass you? I'm sorry. I can't go on. Okay. If you'd like to help before, during, or after the service, see me. It doesn't have to be a full-time job. You won't get paid. And you see my phone number or my email address. We'd love to have you help out. The Oneg Shabbat, for those of you who don't know, is after the service where we have all good things to eat and share a word or two with each other. And it's a wonderful experience. Please visit us on our website, ohavshalomministries.com. Previous sermons can be seen on YouTube channel at Ohav Shalom Messianic Congregation. And if you have any questions, Debbie and the AV squad will be happy to answer them for you. We're also streaming our services live, and we're now on Roku. For those of you watching live, you can donate to our ministry by clicking on the donations link. And you can also submit your prayer request directly to me through the prayer link. And we've had some come in, and we just want to pray for you and have you feel like you're part of our congregation. Davidic dance practice is held out in the foyer each week about 30 minutes before the service. And if you'd like to learn how to dance the Jewish dances, you're welcome to join in and learn how to do them. You see that $12 price? Put a line through it. It's $8 now. Still too much, but it's only $8. Please pray for the homeless of our valley to find water, shelter, food, and most importantly, our Messiah, Yeshua. And this is just a listing coming up of those that we saw this week. Donations could be made, and anything that you can eat or use, they can use. And they're in need of personal hygiene items, tents for shelter, and right over here, we don't have Russ. Where's Anthony today? Out back. Okay. Well, anyway, this wonderful family donates every Saturday morning, and they do a fantastic job, and they really deserve a round of applause. Ohav, you don't have a list of people today? You got the list back there? Okay. All right. Well, how many people did you see? 35 people. And we saved another person. Fantastic. Ohav Shalom immersion baptisms for adults. If you'd like to be baptized the Jewish way, see Ernesto or Donzel after the service, and they can tell you what is required. And it's a beautiful ceremony, and you get wet. Okay, I got to be careful about this so I don't mess up. Rosh Hashanah services are Tuesday evening, October 4th at 7 p.m. That's 3 days from today. Okay. Back with the slide, please. I got more. A week from that day, anyway, is going to be Yom Kippur services. And the next night after that, which is a Wednesday night at 6 o'clock, I'm getting old, it's hard to see these things. We're going to have a pot blessing on Wednesday, October 12th, right here to close out the fast. Bring your food and yourself. 6 p.m. And the Tuesday service for Yom Kippur is at 7 p.m. And then 2 weeks after that, on Saturday, October 22nd, we will have Sukkot services. So it's the Feast of Tabernacles. Thursday nights, we have a street fair downtown Palm Springs. And it's almost like the other ministry that we have for the homeless. We bring the brainless to the Lord. Tuesday night Bible study, first and third Tuesday of each month, 7 p.m. at OHAB. The next study is October 18th. And then we have a congregational prayer meeting at my home on the second and fourth Tuesday of each month, except for this coming month, because that coincides with Yom Kippur. So we will have it on October 25th. Thank you for putting it there, because I couldn't figure that out. And we have on the chairs, we have a 3x5 card. If you'd like us to pray for you, fill out one of these cards and we will pray for you. And if the prayers are answered, we also want to hear from you. And we have a high percentage, I would say 70% of these prayers are answered positively. So prayer does work. If you'd like to come to my house for the prayer meeting, we have directions on the back table, and you're welcome to pick them up or have any questions. Robert, who is part of the AVQ, who's waving his hand, will be happy to show you how to get there. He's made the trip a few times. We want to continue praying for our members who are sick or in need, our unsaved loved ones, and all the persecuted saints around the world, and our national leaders. We also want to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper that love you. And I'd like to call Johnny up to say a prayer.
Thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth. Thank you for the children you gave Yeshua, for signs and wonders in Israel. Thank you for dying for all of our sins. Thank you that you're coming back, and we hope that you come back. We believe that you're coming back. Thank you for the year of Jubilee, the year of release. Thank you for placing us under the past president of the Messianic Jewish Alliance of America, Paul Lieberman, and his wife. Thank you that you brought his wife back from open heart surgery, Father. Thank you for blessing this congregation above measure and increasing our viewing around the world. Thank you that people around the world get to see what takes place in this congregation, Father. We praise you, Yeshua, for all your goodness and letting some of your goodness pass before us, and thank you for all your love. Thank you that there's no violence in you. It's all about love, the love you have for all those people that you begot. You formed us all in the womb. All your enemies, all the enemies of Jerusalem are going to be found liars from before you. They stand before the Son of Man. They're going to be quaking in their boots when they realize that they served others. They were worshiping the creatures. They were not worshiping the Creator of the universe. Thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for setting up the throne of grace for us. Thank you for the gift, the free gift of salvation. And thank you that even our belief in Yeshua is a gift from you, so no man can boast. We pray that you completely rule and govern us And thank you that you placed the 70 kings in the nations, but you overrule the kings. You overrule those nations. They don't think so, but you do. They can't do any. A dog's tongue can't move unless you say so, unless you know about it. Thank you for your presence, and thank you for your Holy Spirit, and thank you for the love fest you're having in heaven, and thank you for rejoicing over all of us. In the mighty name of Yeshua, we pray all these things. Amen. Now it's time to worship the Lord.
He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. That's the beginning of Psalm 91. See if I can read this without my glasses. Where are we? Oh, here it is. Y'all ready?
Not yet.
Good to see all your new faces out here. Sing along with us. We need you, folks. Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing psalms. Here we are. Sing unto the Lord.
Sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord all the earth. Sing unto the Lord. Sing unto the Lord all the earth. Sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord all the earth. Sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord all the earth. For God is great and greatly to be praised. God is great and greatly to be praised.
Your heart envy sinners, but live in the fear of the Lord always. Proverbs 23. Okay. You sound good out there. Keep it up.
Two pages. One, two, three, four. Thank you. shall be called the city of truth, the mountain of the Lord of hosts. Har HaKodesh, for thus says the Lord, I will save my people. I am zealous over Zion. I am zealous over Zion. I am zealous over Zion. I will dwell in Jerusalem. The Lord will go up with a loud trumpet blast, the shout of the angel of God. The Lord shall be king over all of the earth. Adonai Echad. He neti, Zeo, he neti, Zeo, he neti, Zeo. I will dwell in Jerusalem. Will appear faithful and true. With justice he'll judge and make war. His eyes are of fire, his tongue is a sword. Lion of Judah, roar! I am zealous over Zion. I am zealous over Zion. The city of truth, the mountain of the Lord of hosts. Har HaKodesh, for thus says the Lord, I will save my people. I am zealous over Zion. I am zealous over Zion. I am zealous over Zion. I will dwell in Jerusalem. The Lord will go forth with a loud trumpet blast, the shout of the angel of God. The Lord shall be king over all of the earth. Adonai Echad. He neti, lezio, he neti, lezio, he neti, lezio. Faithful and true, with justice he'll judge and make war. His eyes are a fire, his tongue is a sword. Lion of Judah, roar! I am zealous over Zion. I am zealous over Zion. I am zealous over Zion. I will dwell in Jerusalem. I will dwell in Jerusalem. I will dwell in Jerusalem.
Oh. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How'd you like that? Pretty good, huh? Yeah. Let's do it again. Maybe next week. Okay. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish in the way. When his wrath is kindled, but a little, blessed are those who put their trust in him. Psalm 2:12.
Thank you. celebrate alive.
But one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose its seven seals." Revelation. Hallelujah. Woo. Thank you for all of us.
You're the Lion of Judah, the Lamb who was slain. You ascended to heaven and evermore will reign. At the end of the age, when the earth you reclaim, you will gather the nations before you. And the eyes of all men will be fixed on the Lamb who was crucified. With wisdom and mercy and justice, you'll reign at your Father's side. And the angels will cry, "Hail the Lamb who was slain for the world. Who gather before you, and the ears of all men need to hear of the Lamb who was crucified, who descended to hell yet was raised up to reign at his Father's side. And the angels will cry, "Hail the Lamb who was slain for the world, ruling power, and the earth will reply, you shall reign as the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords." You're the Lion of Judah, the Lamb who was slain. You ascended to heaven and evermore will reign. At the end of the age, when the earth you reclaim, you will gather the nations before you. And the eyes of all men will be fixed on the Lamb who was crucified. With wisdom and mercy and justice, has told us, for these you have died, for the nations to gather before you. And the ears of all men need to hear of the Lamb who was crucified, who descended to hell yet was raised up to reign at his Father's side. And the angels will cry, "Hail the slain for the world, ruling power,
As the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. As the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. As the King of all kings and the Lord of lords.
Ooh, hallelujah. Wow. Sing to the Lord, for he has done excellent things. Amen?
Amen.
This is known in all the earth. Isaiah 12, 5. Come, let us sing. Sing out with us again, folks. You sound great. Ooh.
Come forward. Jezvan Usher, you got a lot of work to do today. Okay. You know, I was listening to the worship music and it just hit me like a rock. Hail the Lamb who was slain for the world. I mean, wow. What he did for us is just absolutely incredible. There's no one, nothing like our Lord. And what are we going to do for him? He doesn't ask much of us, 10%. It's his anyway. So let's look to our hearts today. Let us rejoice in him and just fill our tithe to him just unbelievably full. And I have a little passage to read today. Wherefore the runner has entered for us, even Jesus, having become the high priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. Amen. There's more? Oh. That's a lot. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, first being translated king of righteousness, and then also the king of Salem, meaning the king of peace, without father, without mother, without genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like the Son of God, remains a priest continually. Amen.
Woo. Yeah. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever El Shaddai had formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, you are El Shaddai. Psalms 90, verse 2. Oh, yeah. Josh Hammer. Paul, come on up and...
thing. We have some internal housekeeping things that need to be done on this Shabbat, which is a longer service, but that's okay. You know, where's the big hurry? And before this guy leaves, I want to mention that he worked until 4 a.m. this morning and came here anyhow, first guy in the parking lot, huh? Because he felt it was important to be here. Huh? He wants to serve the Lord. Thank you, Chuck.
Amen.
I'm telling you, he's a guy hard to give a compliment to. But that's all right. We forced it on him. Okay, Chuck, go ahead and get some sleep, would you? Okay. All right. All right. We have some other things to make mention of in our service, which is a little unusual today, but... All right, let's take an opportunity to do some things, because during the week I had to, by the way, is William Clark here? William is raising his hand? No, William is not raising his hand. The reason is because William Clark is watching us on live stream. Now, William has come here before on Saturday morning. And he's, you know, he's attended, but he has kind of an edema in his legs, and it's not apparently convenient for him to come here. So, but in coming here, he learned that we have a live stream broadcast at our website, okay, ohavshalomministries.com. So William, he was curious about things, and so he called me. You know, we had a pleasant conversation, and he came to the congregation and so on and so forth. And then during the week, he called me, you know, he called again. Anybody wants to call on that bulletin, there's a telephone number for you to call in case you're interested. All right. And hopefully I'll be at the other end of that call. Okay. And if I'm not there, you call back, or I'll call you. All right. So William calls up, and he's got questions. And... So I proceed to answer his questions, and first question was, William, welcome to the flock. Let's all welcome William to the flock. Because William became a believer this week because of the live stream. So the first question from William's mouth was, let me understand. Do I have to obey the Torah in order to be saved? In order to get into heaven, do I have to obey the Torah, the five books of Moses, or the Old Testament? And I said, well, William, I'm very glad to report you don't got to do nothing. It isn't a matter of what you do or how often you pray. Huh? It doesn't have to do with whether you, about your tithing. And it doesn't have to do with attending, and it doesn't have to do with your good deeds. None of that's getting you into heaven. Uh-uh. It doesn't make any difference insofar as getting into heaven. What that's not required. Oh, yeah? What other questions you got? All right. And he went down a series of things that had been bothering him that were in his mind, and he thought, oh, well, maybe this guy can help me. After a conversation about each of his curiosities, I came back and said, well, William, you've expressed an interest in getting to heaven if you could. And I've explained to you that the doing of things is like under the law of sowing and reaping, that there's consequences to whatever we do. Do good things and you'll reap good benefits. Do bad things and you'll get bad repercussions. And so that's all it is. And all that is in this life. All right? And if you are connected with God, and if you are a born-again believer, it has nothing to do with your next life, because if you're a believer, It says of the believers, those who are born again, those who have accepted the Messiah, those who are connected with God and part of God's family, they will be separated from their sins as far as the east is from the west. So any bad pictures you got in your mind, when you, if you're a believer, you can forget about them, because once you leave this veil of flesh, it's of no concern. But it sounded like you really want to be connected with God. You really want a personal relationship with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, don't you? He says, yeah, I really do. So I said, well, it doesn't have to do with whether you do good deeds or bad deeds. Well, what does it have to do with? It has to do with the blood of atonement. Oh, the blood, yeah, that'll get you in. So he proceeded to ask a lot of questions about what is this blood of atonement about? Well, because God tells us. You got questions? God's got answers. For the life of the flesh, the very center of our beings, is in the blood. And I provided it for you as an atonement for your souls. And if you want to know more about this, you come back or you call me. Okay? Because if you have never prayed to receive a personal relationship with the inventor of the universe, if this has never been something that you want, and if you are concerned about your future when this decaying body leaves, then you call me or you come back here, because we have answers for you. The stakes are high. Do it while it seems like a good idea. Okay. So today is a special day because of William. I've been celebrating all week. But we have other people who, during the year, this happens also. And they've begun a new journey. Behold, all things become new. Become new creatures in the Messiah. And who wouldn't want to have that? It's like there's something good offered, but that can't be. It's just too good to be true, and I'm not worthy. Forget about being worthy. Okay? Just grab on. You need a Messiah to help you in your life. You need to know that your prayers are answered. You need to know where you're going when this life is over. You call me or you come back. Hallelujah. See what I mean about it being a little longer service today? Old Big Mouth is just having a field day. Give the kid a microphone, he goes nuts. Well, I know today may not be the day. I should be abbreviating things, but I can't help it. We're having a wedding today, and it took special preparations. Now, our wedding couple, boy, have they emphasized to me, Paul, make it short, make it sweet, and make it simple. A very simple ceremony. And they didn't have to tell me three times, but they told me six times. Paul, we want it short, and we want an abbreviated and simple ceremony. If you can do that, Paul. They weren't sure.
Can you do it, Paul?
They weren't sure. So at the end of our service, instead of ending in the usual way, we're going to have a wedding ceremony. I know a lot of you are here, or some of you are here for that purpose. You know, at 10:52 last night, my wife and I got an email from the folks who were leaving the building here after making preparations. 10:52. That by the time they got out the door, it's 11 o'clock. 11 o'clock. Why were they here? Making preparations for a wedding because they are overjoyed with the prospect of some folks that they know getting married, and they're rejoicing, and this is their way of helping to celebrate. Huh. I don't know if I mentioned all the people who were here, but I know that, raise your hands, because I want people to know who you are. Loretta Davis and Michelle Studer. Michelle, come on now. Where the heck is Michelle? She's off. Okay. And Noelia? Huh? Navarro? Well, see, they're back there preparing, you know. And their daughter Faith? Huh? Then we have all the food bringers. You know, they work at home and they bring stuff because it's a joy for them. This is a way of participating in the Lord's work. This is an act of love. nothing in return, asking nothing in return. And I'm telling you, this congregation, the Messianic movement at large, it is the sum cumulative total of personal sacrifice. We don't got no wealthy people. We don't got no famous people, but we got personal sacrifice. I'm telling you, it's great to be part of it. And that got me to thinking further about what the heck is going on in this congregation. I mean, I'm looking back over the expanse of the last 3 years, and I'm saying, what the heck? We got a street fair. We got street evangelism going on, huh? Yeah. We got Gary and Larry and John and Frank and others that show up on Thursday night. You know, sometimes it's hot, sometimes it's cold, but they're out there. And we got Claudia and Russell. Come on, raise your hands. Yeah. They're out there, and both the homeless ministry and the street evangelism is every week. There's 35 or so meaningful conversations. Huh? And then we got, I mentioned the Navarro and Studer families. Huh? Come on, raise your hands here, because they are involved with the maintenance. They are here. First one's here, 8 o'clock in the morning and before, and the last one's to leave at 2 o'clock. I mean, every week. You know, who's cleaning up the place, and so on and so forth. And David Iniguez, he's mopping the floors every week, you know. Anybody notice these things? No, everybody's gone home. And then the street evangelism is headed by Donzel Jones. Hey, Donzel is, raise your hand, come on. Very quiet guy, but now Donzel comes up with a new deal. He says, let's have a prison ministry. These people are getting out someday. Huh? So we just filled out the applications this week to have a prison ministry. So this is becoming a full-fledged ministry with all kinds of appurtenances and arms and legs, and things are happening and so on and so forth. And then people are watching us, you know, on the live stream and reporting back to us that they're actually getting something out of it. Then we got this music ministry. I'm telling you, we lose ourselves in the music ministry because it expresses our hearts. And, you know, that takes practice. That takes practice. These are not professionals. But did you know that they meet on every Friday night to practice? Huh? At Chuck Waller's home, you know? And they kind of have an open invitation. If others want to go there and sing with them or listen to the music, you know, that's possible. But it's a sacrifice to do it. Then we got Monty and James there doing high-tech ministry on our behalf. And there's Brian Glick, who's not here today. But Brian is, he takes care of the visuals normally. And you know what? We live in a dangerous age. You know, suppose somebody comes in here and starts spraying with bullets. We got us a security guy who is equipped to deal with that. And he's here every week. You're protected. And you've been protected. You just didn't know it. But these things don't happen by accident. And it takes training and so on and so forth. But people want to serve the Lord. We got Bible studies. And we got prayer meetings. Judy and Gary and Julie, they put it on every week as a social event. Huh? What about the dance ministry? It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. Learning Israeli dances and so on and so forth. We got a reception. We got Elizabeth. We got ushers, Jim McCracken and Ernesto and David Iniguez and so on and so forth. And Ernesto does translation into Spanish. And so you begin to see it's beginning to add up. Is there Gary does printing for free for us as a contribution? And what about the children's ministry? You know, I get to be a big a public personality and so on and so forth. I shoot off my big mouth here every week. It takes just as much preparation to teach the children. We got us somebody back there who's preaching and teaching to the children where it really pays off. Over the age of 25 years old, people get very taken with themselves and they don't buy into these ideas because of pride. But the children, they're open vessels. And it will, and there's maybe a bigger payoff with the children than there is with the adults. Huh? Yeah. What about those Studer girls who are here with the dancing and the class and serving, and these kids are here all the time, 6 hours. I mean, that's hard. That's not so easy for a kid, you know, but they love it. Why do they love it? Because their parents love it, and because there's something that they feel that they're getting out of it. Then we have Ronnie and Jerry Cohen who help with the liturgy and so on and so forth. You know, we got a lot going here, and I haven't even mentioned all of them. I added all of these up. It takes 35 people doing something to make a congregation and to have a service. To have this service today took the work of 35 people. And then there's my wife, huh? She's a handy dander helper in all areas, including being a looker after of the husband. Now, we're also on YouTube, okay? And there is someone who is unable to watch us on live stream because they run their own congregation on Saturday mornings. But they listen to the sermons only, which are provided on YouTube. And I want to mention his name because it deserves to be an honored name. Huh? His name is Steve Babko. He was the founder of the congregation. Some plant, as he did, some water, as many of you have done. And here I am reaping the benefits of all those foundation stones that Steve laid. That needs to be said, and I've said it. And Steve, you're watching on YouTube, huh? And I'm so glad that you are, and I'm so glad that you are given your proper credit for having founded this congregation and worked at it for 20 years. Thank you, Steve. Okay, got all said. That wasn't so bad, was it? Okay. So with that, I want to ask the children to come forward, and Carol, for you to come forward as well. Okay, Bruce, come on. Who else am I going to call on here today? Ronnie, come on up. Ronnie, come on up. Need you tall guys, because our children are getting to be not so small. Huh? I embarrass Jack here all the time because there's something going on with Jack. You know, at 7 years old, he's just overgrown like this. Okay, Bruce, please speak to the Lord about the children's class.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for these precious children. And thank you that you love them and you want to bless them. And we pray, Lord, that they will just love to have creation in your house, Lord, and that they will enjoy heaven. Bless Carol as she ministers to them, and that she just be full of your Holy Spirit and show them the love of Jesus. And we ask this in Yeshua HaMashiach.
Amen. Glory to God. Okay. Now, our betrothed couple, okay, you know, out of modesty, they really want a very simple thing and not long. And so, what to do? You know, I want to do the ceremony, and I want to do it the way they want, but, you know, it's usual to say something about, you know, the institution of marriage. So that's what we're going to talk about today in the message. Okay. Why are we not surprised? All right. So we want to ask the Lord to bless the message. All right. We want to pray to the Holy Spirit to give the message. And I'll try to get out of the way so that that can happen. Please join me in a word of prayer. How good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Lord, we thank you that where we're gathered together in your name, that your Holy Spirit does come and speak the message that is in all of our hearts. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that we invited you into our hearts, that you penetrated our hearts, and that, behold, all things did become new because we were a new creation. We became born again. Our spirit man was electrified somehow, charged, and it became revitalized, and suddenly we had a relationship with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the one in charge of everything, who has infinite capacities. Now, Holy Spirit, in your infinite capacity, speak to us this morning, and we'll just pray in Yeshua's name. Amen. So what shall it be? I've attended many wedding ceremonies, and, there's various messages to speak about. But I'm going to speak about the one that I like. Why are we not surprised? Well, the one that it's not the usual one, but it's the one that it kind of excites me. So please turn to Genesis chapter 24. Now, in Genesis 24, we have a romance, not a usual romance, okay? It has to do with a bride and a groom who didn't really know one another. In fact, not at all. What did they go by? How could they make such a big life commitment to one another, never even having seen one another? That's a big deal. That's a big deal. Now, the man, he's kind of taking on some responsibility here because he's going to provide some stability, and he's going to be a provider. He's going to go out into the world and handle things for her. And if somebody bigger than her comes along, he's going to protect her, and he's going to help her in her decision making. On her part. She's going to be a helpmate. Rather than pursuing her own glory, she's going to pursue the glory of this guy who she's hitched her wagon to. And she's going to try to help the implementation of his ideas and programs that he has. It's kind of like being a bride says, I guess what I really want is, I want to help you. I want you to succeed. And men just marvel at it. How do women do that? How do women do that? I should pay attention. Maybe I can learn something from the women. My bride of 52 years is still teaching me. But I'm slow to catch on, but in latter years, I'm beginning to pay attention. Okay. So our saga begins here. It says, when Abraham was old and was well stricken in age, and the Lord had blessed Abraham in all things. He had become a wealthy rancher. And Sarah, his wife, has passed away. Okay. And the year here is about 1860 BC, 1857 BCE, my Bible says, before the Common Era, or BC. And now there's no scriptures. No Torah been written, no Psalms, no Proverbs, no New Testament. But they have an idea about God. They can tell the will of God. Well, they look up in the stars, and they see they're well in touch with the nature. And they watch the guiding hand of Providence. Certain things are blocked, certain things are facilitated. Is God behind them, and so on? And Abraham said to his eldest servant of his house that ruled over all that he had, put, I pray thee, thy hand under thy thigh. I will make thee swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of the earth, that thou shalt not take a wife unto my son and the daughter of the Canaanites among whom I dwell. But thou shalt go unto my country, or my former country, in Ur of Chaldee, and to my kindred, and take a wife unto my son Isaac from some of my somewhat distant family. Why is he doing this? He has a son of promise, came to him at 99 years old, to an 86-year-old wife, now passed on. And the whole deal that he's lived his whole life for is on this promise given to him at age 75 years old, and it was all contingent on, it was all tied up in his son, the son of promise, and his progeny. And what about it, Isaac? You meet anybody? You dating anybody? Isaac's 40 years old. Doesn't seem to have any interest in women whatsoever. Can you imagine how Abraham felt? Abraham was patient, but you know, come on, son, let's get her going here, because you remember we got the promise, and the promise ain't going nowhere unless you get yourself a wife and you start having some children. So, you know, I'm interested in your future and your marital status. Can't blame Abraham for that. All right, we're moving down to verses 7 and 8. And we're just dwelling in this one chapter today, but it's long. The Lord God of heaven, which took me from... So here he asks his servant to go and to find a bride for Isaac. And so he goes off into the Chaldee, which is roughly today Iraq. And there's an instruction given. He says, and he shall send his angel before thee, and thou shalt take a wife unto my son from there. So he says, the Lord God of heaven, which took my father's house, took me from my father's house and my land and my kindred and so on and so forth, and spoke to me about my future, and saying to me, unto thy seed I will give this land, he shall send an angel before thee, and so on. So now here is Abraham's servant. And Abram is saying to him, look, I know I'm sending you on a mission. I asked you to put your hand under my thigh because we're involved in an intimate thing going on here. This is very important. This is a solemn thing we're doing. And don't be apprehensive about it, because God's going to send an angel who's going to put the right thoughts in your mind. Oh, God does that? Yeah, God can send an angel to give you a thought. As a matter of fact, he's doing it all the time. Yeah, sometimes we're not paying attention, but just like Abraham's servant could receive a thought from an angel, so can we. All right, verse 11. And so he made his camels to kneel down outside the city. He goes and travels this distance. As the crow flies, it's about 600 miles. But that's all desert, so he probably had to go up the north of the Fertile Crescent. It was a very long trip, easily. You know, we're talking about like 1,000 miles here. Yeah. And so it's, you know, between two verses, it doesn't sound like much, but this is a big deal. So he comes to the city where his Abram's family came from, and he made his camels to kneel down without the city by a well of water, at the time of the evening, even the time that women go out to draw the water. And he said, oh, Lord, what am I going to do? I got this assignment. I don't want to fail. Well, that's a little bit of an elaboration, but we'll go with it. And he said, oh, Lord God of my master Abraham, I pray thee and send me good speed this day and show kindness unto my master Abraham. Behold, I stand here by the well of water, and the daughters of the men of the city come out to draw water. And let it come to pass that the damsel to whom I shall say, let down thy pitcher, I pray thee that I may drink, and she will say, drink, and I will give your camels drink also. Let the same be she that thou hast appointed for my servant Isaac, and thereby shall I know that thou hast shown kindness unto my master. He's putting out a fleece. He's saying, how will I know? Of the different women here, how will I know which one is the one? Can't make a mistake. The future of Abraham's seed depends upon a right decision here. a lot at stake. Oh Lord, help me. Help me. Let the right woman be the one who volunteers and is not just helpful, but very helpful. Let her say this about the drink and the camels. Yeah, you know, it's very specific. Verse 15, and it came to pass that after he had done speaking, that behold, Rebekah came out, who was born of Bethuel, son of Milcah, the wife of Nahor, Abraham's brother, with her pitcher upon her shoulder. And the damsel was very fair to look upon, and a virgin. Neither had any man known her, and she went down to the well and filled her pitcher and came up. So let's see. There's the prayer. Now here comes a woman. Is this the one, or should I look for another? And the servant ran to meet her and said, let me, I pray thee, drink a little water of your pitcher. And she said, drink, my lord. And she hasted and let down her pitcher upon her hand and gave him to drink. And when she had done giving him to drink, she said, I will draw water for your camels also until they have had done drinking. And she hasted and emptied her pitcher into the trough and ran again unto the well to draw water and drew for all of his camels. This is a very helpful person. Huh? She had her things. She had her agenda. She had her things to do. She had her responsibility. This is a stranger, probably never going to see this guy ever again. Who the heck is he? Huh? But, and he wants something to drink. Oh, sure thing. But she's, you know, to go to this extra effort and to do the humble task of bringing water for his camels. Who needs this extra duty? But she does it. She feels led to do it. And he says, bing, bing. She just said the thing I asked the Lord to have the right woman say. Let me see. There's an angel going to speak to me, and I had this thought that that the woman is supposed to ask to give water to me and my camels, and that's exactly what she did. That must be the angel and that thought that he gave to me that I said in my prayer, and now she's doing it. Bing! This is very unusual and beats the long odds. Mm-hmm. He's looking. How will I know? Well, he's got some really good clues going on here. Verse 23. And said, whose daughter are you? What family did you come from? Tell me, I pray thee, is there room in your father's house for us to lodge? And she said unto him, I am the daughter of Bethuel of Milcah, bore unto Nahor. Oh, Nahor, that's Abraham's brother. Yeah, she's from the right family. There's various other families, but she comes from Bethuel and from Milcah and from Nahor, which are the names that Abraham gave me. Bing! She not only fulfilled the prescription, but she's from the right family. That's good. So far, so good. This is working out. Let's go further. Verse 25, she said moreover unto him, we have both straw and enough and room to lodge in. And the man bowed down his head and worshiped the Lord. He said, oh, thank you, Lord. He says, I being in a way led me to the house of my master's brethren. What a great thing. I mean, right away, I was led by circumstances to the house of the relatives of Abraham, just like he said. And here's this woman who comes from the right lineage, and she asked, and then there was this curious thing about feeding my camel's thirst and so on. And then it says, and the damsel ran and told them of their mother's house these things. It says that Rebecca ran. We got us some enthusiasm. She's kind of interested and electrified with all this. Who the heck is he? And he's come here looking for our family. And he's a stranger. You got to meet this guy. So there's something exciting. She doesn't know exactly why yet, but there's something exciting going on here with this stranger, okay, whose camels I just gave water to. So he's kind of related this event, and she sees the providence in it. Hey, I didn't have to do that. Why did I do that? I don't do that for everybody. And I am from the right family. And he's fulfilling an instruction. And he traveled all these many, many, many hundreds of miles to get here for this specific task. And, you know, I mean, this is very strange. Mom, you gotta meet this guy. There's something special going on here. That's why she ran. She's excited over prospects. And so verse 33 says, so he's invited to come to the house because they want to meet him and he wants to meet them. And there was set meat before him to eat, and he said, I will not eat until I have told you of my errand. Verse 35, and the Lord hath blessed my master greatly. That means he's rich. And he has become great, and he has given him flocks and herds and silver and gold and manservants and maidservants and camels and donkeys. And Sarah, my master's wife, bore him a son to my master when he was old, and unto him he hath given him all that he has. There's a big inheritance. I'm here to find a bride for my master's son, but he's very wealthy, huh? And he's up there in years. And he's giving his entire inheritance to this son. In case you want to provoke your interest, he's going to be a wealthy son. Yeah. Verse 35. So he says, I'm Abraham's servant, and the Lord has given him a lot of goods. But so then we move on to verse 50. We're coming to the end of it. So then Laban and Bethuel answered and said, the thing proceedeth from the Lord. We cannot speak unto this is good or bad. So they're recognizing this is way beyond coincidence. Way beyond coincidence. But for a decision like this, for Rebecca to throw in with this, and she's supposed to go 1,000-plus miles on a prospect of a guy she's never met before, huh? And, yeah, she'd be wealthy, but we love her. And do we want to impose this upon her? This is going to have to be in verse 51. This is going to have to be, we're going to have to ask her about this. Yeah. So we move on to verses 57 and 58, which are the last verses that we're going to take up today. And they said, we will call the damsel and inquire at her mouth. And they said, Rebecca. And she said, will you go with this man? And she said, I will go. She didn't say, let me think about it overnight. I think that I ponder it, so on and so forth. I'll consider it. They asked, and she says, I will go. Why did she respond so quickly? Because she sensed the Lord was in it. There was a sign that this guy was given instruction. He's traveled all these miles, and he had a thing that he prayed to the Lord about the feeding of the drink to he and his camels. And I did it. And I don't know why I did it. I just did it. I don't do that for everybody. And then hearing the tale about how he's come on assignment. And so on. There was something in her inner being that said, just go with it. Just yield to this. This is right. I can't put my finger on it, but somehow God is in this. Somehow God is in this. It's way beyond chance, and I'm from the right family, very specifically prescribed by Abraham. Well, between the instruction on the camels and being from the right family, and this guy's traveled all this way, and he is interested specifically in me. He's not looking any further. She says, I see the Lord in this, and I'm going to swing with it. I don't understand it, but I'm going to swing with it. And it reminds you about becoming a believer. I didn't understand all this stuff. I didn't begin to understand it, but I said, I don't get it, but I get it enough to know that God's in it. I'm going to swing with it. Yeah, we can identify with that, can't we? Huh? That's how we felt when we became believers. We didn't get it. We didn't understand it all. We just said, I understand enough to swing with it. So, will you go? I will go. I promised those would be the last verses, but here's a surprise. Because we're getting to the most exciting part. I just want to jump up and shout about this. On verses 63, it tells what now happens. She gets on the camel, and she's now going to go on this very long journey up the Fertile Crescent, okay, not across the desert, and she's now going to make this long schlep. All right, in verse 63, it says, when Isaac, so now that she's traveled all this way to a guy that she has yet to meet, on the thin threads that God is in this, and I'm gambling everything I got, my future, on that I'm correct that God is in this. The stakes are high for her. And she now approaches, verse 63, and Isaac went out to meditate in the field. Oy, yay, yay, what's going to be with my life? At evening time, so the sun's going down. There's a decreasing amount of light. And he lifted up his eyes and saw, and behold, there's camels coming. On the horizon, there's camels coming. Verse 64, and Rebekah lifted up her eyes when she saw Isaac. She lighted off the camel. She has not really seen his face yet. But she sees that there is the promise of this guy, huh? And it's the one meant for her from God. And she is saying, I can't wait. I can't wait. I can play hard to get. Yes, I can be a prim and proper person, but I can't stand it. I'm getting off this camel and I'm going to run because I am that excited because God has chosen this one and I just can't wait. I got to see what he's all about. I'm going to gamble everything on it. I just got to see. So she's off the camel and she's now running. She's running. She just can't get there fast enough to know what her future is. And now, verse 65, where she had said unto her servant, what man is like this that walks in the field to meet us? So he's walking and she's running. And the servant had said, it's my master. Therefore, she took a veil and covered herself. Now comes the modesty. Okay. All right. She's willing to run towards her future, to grab onto her future. Okay. She's going to be the helpmate. She's going to give her life. She's going to hitch her wagon to this unknown guy, gamble everything on him. Huh? And now she says, but let me be modest in his sight. Huh? I want to give him an outward sign that I'm going to defer to him. I'm going to be a helpmate. And so on. That I'm going to be easy to get along with. That's a little embellishment on my part. And the servant told Isaac all things that he had done. So now the servant reports to Abraham and tells about this adventure with the family. And Isaac brought her into his mother Sarah's tent. Sarah's died. Okay. But what he does is he says, let's seal the deal here and come into my mother's tent. I guess there's going to be some kind of marital, he's going to know her in the biblical sense. And she became his wife, and he loved her, and Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. Could be that Isaac was a mama's boy. He needed to be comforted after his mother's death, and maybe that's what was awaiting his desire to have a wife, was he had female companionship from his mother. So, what does that have to do with us? Happened a long time ago. Well, there is something in theology called typology. God sets up a formula that's going to be repeated. God has a plan. God has always had a plan from the invention of human beings. All right? And this plan was going to be that there would be three parts of God. He'd have a body, he'd have a creative mind, and a spirit, the Holy Spirit, and so on and so forth. And so he creates man, but he creates man in two parts, the male and the female. and they're two parts of one whole. Why? Because there's going to be a whole progeny of people who he wants to convey a concept to. And the concept has to do the concept of the male and female, the bride and the groom. The male will have one part and the female will have another part. The male is to be the protector, provider, giver of direction, and the female, she's to be the helpmate, the one who is the future of the man's program. People didn't understand it. People today don't mostly understand it. But it's a formula, because God was pointing to the future of mankind, and the future of mankind was that there was going to be a bridegroom and there was going to be a bride. And the bridegroom was going to be the Messiah. The Messiah was going to be someone who would provide for us, and he would protect us, and he would give us direction. Huh? And aggregately, or individually, but I'm just going to stay with aggregately, we, the believers, are the bride. Yeah. And so, as we, the believers, are the bride, we now look at Rebecca, and here it is, we have never seen the Messiah face to face. But we're out of our chairs. We're running towards it. Oh, yes, I have to see the Messiah. How soon can I see my Messiah? I'm off the camel. I'm running towards him. I just have to see what my future is. How fast can I get there? Let me be deferential. Let me show my submissiveness. I'm going to put a veil over. I just want to take my proper place and be a helpmate. Oh, it would be so gratifying just to be his wife. And in the aggregate, that's what the body does. The body is today called the church. Well, I don't like to call it the church. I like to call it the body. Same thing. But in the aggregate, that's who we are. We're all Rebecca, jumping off our camel, eager to see the Messiah, pledging ourselves to be the helpmate. And God saw this in the beginning. That's why he created us in two parts, male and female. Because he was pointing to the future. Because he is, as a Messiah, he is the male part, and we is all the female. Men, we have to learn better how to become the female. You know, the male attributes are so highly prized in our society. But really, really, we are the students of how to be a bride. That's what we're supposed to do in this life, is how we have to learn how to be a bride. So observe carefully. If you got a bride, observe carefully how well she does it. If you don't got a bride, you watch my wife. I got me a good one. I got me a very good one. Matter of fact, I sit there and I marvel. How did I ever fall into such a good thing? She's the best looker after that I could have ever imagined. I didn't realize what I was doing. All I knew was she was a good kisser and a good dancer. That's enough. Little did I know, I wasn't a believer. But there was something about her that struck a responsive chord. I saw that she was willing to give everything. And I was so touched by it. I said, I don't understand it. I know one thing. It's her or nobody. I decided to gamble, it's her. And you know what? Little by little, I began to see that God had this wonderful plan. This wonderful plan. So that's the meaning of being a husband and of being a wife. It's part of the typology organized in the Garden of Eden, where the male is the Messiah, okay, and the female is all of us in the aggregate. That's what we're doing. How do you become part of the bride? How do you become part of the bride? I want to become part of the bride, because what's going to happen is the bride and the groom, at times in the future, we're betrothed to the Messiah. We're the betrothed bride of the Messiah. And it's coming that there's going to be a marriage supper of the Lamb, where all the people who are part of the bride and the groom are going to have a great wedding ceremony. Huh? Forget about the ceremony. We're going right to the marriage. Okay? And now, yeah, let's applaud that. And now we say, yeah, I want to be part of the wedding. Because if I'm marrying into the family of God, I mean, there's God the Father, God the Son, and a Holy Spirit. I mean, three parts. I'm made just like a human being. Three parts, a body, a mind, a Holy Spirit. Yeah, and the inventor of the universe, of every cell and every atom and the galaxies. And oh, what a guy. I mean, he's the inventor of everything. I cannot grasp it, and so on and so forth. He invented, he controls, he has authority. He's infinite in every way, and so on and so forth. And me, I can marry into this family. I can marry into the God. I can marry into the family of all authority, where everything is decided, and He has everything to say, and nothing can overcome Him. And I got dragged with my father-in-law. Hey, buy me in. I want to be part of the bride. I want to be the bride of Messiah. I'm marrying into this family. It's a wealthy family. They got everything. Who wouldn't want to be the bride? Oh. Say, well, who wouldn't want to be part of the bride? Huh. Is it hard? William Clark said, what do I have to do? What do I have to do to be saved? What? Do I have to obey everything? Forget about that measuring up business. All God wants you to do is say, I believe you. I'm not believing the other guy. I'm not doubting. I believe what you said in Leviticus about how I get to be at one with you. I get to buy into the family by accepting that the blood of atonement was shed for me, a perfect sacrifice, not infected by a human being that was in the fallen condition, but one born of a virgin who did not inherit any physical father's sin nature. Yeah, that's all I gotta do. That's all I do. And I can marry in, I can marry up. Yeah. You say, well, who wouldn't want to do that? I mean, the stakes are very high. Eternal life or the lack of it. And my body's decaying very fast. Huh? And who wouldn't want to do that? What do I have to do to be saved? Yeah. Well, William Clark asked the question. You may be asking the question also. All you got to do is believe God. That's all you got to do. Just believe Him. Just believe His word. Just believe in what He said, that the blood of atonement will get you in. Just believe that only one Messiah could fulfill hundreds of messianic prophecies in the Old Testament. Only believe. You see, that was the problem in the Garden of Eden. There was a challenge by the snake, by the serpent. Don't believe him. And so some people have stupidly chosen and are still listening to them. Don't believe God. We say, oh no, I'm going to believe him. He says it in the Bible. I believe it. I got to find more out of what he said. But that's the basic choice. Believe him or don't believe him. That's it. Believe in the blood of atonement. Pray to receive the Lord or don't. Real simple. Real simple book. Real simple concept. Real simple to do. Takes a little bit of guts. Who got the guts? Call me or come back. I can get you into eternal life. Or there are many people around this room. They'll be glad to help as well. Okay. So,